All right, Impact Church family, are y'all ready for God's word today? You ready? Would you do me a favor? Stand to your feet. Come on, stand to your feet. If you're ready for the word, look at somebody next to you and tell them, I've never been more ready. Let them know, I've never been. Okay, just make sure. Before I let you seat, I want to read from Luke chapter 2 in the story of Christmas today, the true Christmas story. And this is what it says, Luke chapter 2. It says, in those days, Caesar Augustus, he issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. Verse 3, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the line of David. Verse 5, he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. Verse 7, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Would you read that last sentence out loud with me? Ready? Here we go. She wrapped him in cloths, and this is your outside voice out loud. Ready? Here we go. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. So today I've titled my message, Making the Most of What I've Got. And before we get into it, I'm going to pray. Would you bow your heads with me? Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. God, we thank you for the true meaning of Christmas, that our Savior has been born. God, we are so grateful that you love us so much. You gave us your one and only Son. Today, God, we believe, we trust in you with our life. We trust in you with our future. We pray this in Jesus' name. We all say, amen. Amen. Before you're seated, look at somebody and tell them, I may not have much, but Jesus is all I need. Come on, let somebody know. I may not have much, but Jesus is all I need. How about a round of applause for our worship team once again? The Christmas is 6 days away. 6 days. And I know that for some people, Christmas, the season of Christmas, holidays in general, can be extremely difficult. I know for some people, this Christmas is a difficult time. Maybe you feel like, man, I don't have much this Christmas. This is a Christmas for you where the future is a big question mark. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe you've lost a loved one, and that's going to make Christmas difficult. Maybe you suffered through a divorce this year, and Christmas is going to be very challenging. Maybe you're just all alone, and that has its challenges. Maybe your money is tight, your finances are tight, and you're just broken, and Christmas is going to be hard. Listen, if any of those are you, if today you're in this Christmas season, and it's a difficult one for you, I want you to know that I prayed for you this week. I prayed for your family this week. I also want you to know that God sees you and God sees your pain. God knows everything about your situation. And I want to talk to you today about four choices. Somebody say choices. I want to talk about four choices that you can make that you will make the most out of what you've got. And so if you're ready, I want you to just touch somebody and tell you, I can't wait. Come on, I can't wait. I cannot wait. Number one, if you're going to make the most with what you've got, number one, choose to have a heart of worship. Choose to have, I got four of you with me. I got to spend some time on this point. Choose to have a heart of worship. Choose. Life is about choices. It's about choices. You make your choices, and your choices make you. You get to choose your reactions and your responses to every life situation. Nobody gets to tell you how to react. Nobody gets to tell you how to respond. You make those choices, and those choices make you. You can choose to feel sorry for yourself. Some people do. You can choose to be negative or discouraged or sad, because some people make that choice. You can choose to be bitter, but you can also choose to have a heart of worship. You can also choose to make worship a priority. And by the way, worship of our Savior is exactly what Christmas is all about. It is about worshiping Jesus. Listen, the heartbeat of Christmas is worship. Worship is not, and we know this, but worship is not about Santa Claus. It's not about the elves. It's not about the movies. It's not about the trees. It's not about ornaments. It's not about stockings. It's not about presents. It's not about Christmas lights. Christmas is about worshiping the Savior of the world. It is about worshiping the newborn King. In Matthew 2, verse 11, the Christmas story, it talks about wise men. And the wise men, it says this, it says, "And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh." Okay, look at this part of this verse. They fell down and worshiped him. They fell down and worshiped him. That is the heart of Christmas. That is the most pure choice you can make this Christmas, is to worship God anyway. Life does not have to be great for you to worship God. Life does not have to be perfect for you to give God praise. You can worship God like the wise men in a barn. You can worship God if you're broke. You can worship God if you're broken. Conditions might not be perfect. Your situation might not be perfect. It might not be great at all. In fact, it wasn't a great situation for the wise men and for Mary and for Joseph and for Jesus. He was born in a manger. The Savior of the world born in a manger because there was no room for him. Let that one sink in for a minute. Okay? He created room for us in this world, and then the world didn't have room for him. Conditions weren't perfect because Jesus, his parents, Mary and Joseph, and the wise men were all on the run from King Herod, who wanted to kill the firstborn babies under 2 of age. Conditions weren't perfect. None of this was ideal. Born in a barn surrounded by animals, none of this offers the accommodations of royalty. You know, one of the most shocking books in the Bible to me is the book of Job. And I know that some of you know what the book of Job is about. Others of you, you thought it was called Job, and you need a job, so you've been reading through the book of Job, hoping that God would open a door. But the book of Job is crazy because Job was a man of God. He was a man of God. He was, the Bible says, he was righteous and he was blameless and he was upright before God. It says he feared God and he shunned evil. This was a man of God, the most influential, the most affluential person on the planet. He was healthy, he was wealthy, he had a big family, he was married with 10 kids, 7 sons, 3 daughters. He had so much wealth. To say he's rich was an understatement. The Bible says he had 7,000 sheep. He had 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen. He had 500 donkeys. But this is where the story gets really wild, because the Bible says that Satan goes to God and he has this conversation with God. And he's like, yeah, of course your servant Job is awesome. Of course he's righteous and blameless and holy. Of course he fears you and shuns evil. You've handed life to him on a silver platter. He's got your hedge of protection around him, God. Hey, I got an idea, God. Remove your hedge from he and his family, and let's see who Job really is. Does that not terrify you? It terrifies me in 2 ways. One, that the devil is going to God and having a conversation about destroying your life. That's terrifying. But two, the fact that God could remove his heads from your life is also just as terrifying. Listen, without God's heads, Job is toast. It's over. In fact, the book of Job, it tells us that he lost everything in one day. He lost it all in one single day. Everything. Listen, I want to talk to you in here that are comfortable in life today. You don't need anything. You make great money. You got a great job. You might be wealthy. You have your health. You have your family. You are just, everything is just comfortable for you. Let me just say it like this. Don't think for a second that you can't lose it all tomorrow. Don't you think for a second that you're the one in control of all that. Don't you think for a second that the blessings of God on your life are there to put a hedge around you, and that every blessing that you have in life is because of the grace and the mercy and the blessing and the hedge of protection on your life. You can lose it in an instant. In an instant. And I've seen people lose it in an instant. I could tell you story after story of people who have had what we would consider everything, and they lost everything in a blink of an eye. I personally know a family, and I've known this family for probably 30 years, a God-fearing couple, husband and a wife. They've been faithful to each other, faithful to God. They've had 6 children, and all in the last 5 years, 3 of them died. We just found out 2 days ago that the father now has a mass growing in his intestines. This is a modern day Job story. To think that you can't lose it all in an instant. Listen, I don't care how wealthy you are. I don't care. You like the fittest person in Scottsdale, and Scottsdale is the fit of the fit, but you're the fit of the fit of the fit. I don't care how healthy, how wealthy, how much peace you have in your mind, how much joy, how many worldly possessions you have, which model of Range Rover or Bentley or Rolls Royce you have, which gated community you live in. Is it? I almost said some, but I better not. I don't want y'all to get mad at me. I always think of my life as walking through the middle of the Red Sea. Like, I'm walking through the miracle of God, and at any given moment, those waters could just close in on me because I'm not the one that's holding them back. God is. And only because of God's hedge of protection around my life. See, Job lost everything. He lost his health. He lost his wealth. He lost his family. He lost his reputation. Job lost it. Everything in a single day. His livestock were all stolen. His 10 children died in the same day, in the same moment, when a storm came through and flattened his house and killed his children. His wife turned on him and said, "You must be living in sin. You need to curse God and die." But I didn't come here to depress you this morning. I promise. I came to tell you about the choice Job made. And I want to read his choice, his response to his situation. Would you look at it with me in Job chapter 1, verses 20 and 21? It says, At what? At the news of his 10 children just dying. At this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship. And he said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked will I depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." Man. See, perspective is everything. Perspective is everything. Like, how? How? See, it's hard to put yourself in this story. It's hard when I think about my own life. It's hard to think of my babies, all 3 dying in the same moment. It's hard to think of my wife turning on me. It's hard to think of why would God allow this when I know that I'm upright and righteous in doing what God wants me to do. But when you personalize it, that's what the Bible's for. It's for you. When you personalize it, it makes the situation come alive. And I don't know how. How? I've asked myself this question every time I've read the story of Job. How did he lose it all? And look what it says. Then he fell to the ground in worship. And perspective is, came into this world with nothing. I'm taking nothing out of this world. Blessed be the name of the Lord. How? Because he had a choice. And you have a choice too. No matter how difficult your situation is, no matter how bad your marriage looks, no matter how bad your finances look, no matter how bad your health looks, no matter how bad your mental health looks, you have a choice. You have a choice. You get to choose how you respond and you react. And listen, not only did Job make a choice, are you ready for this? Job made a choice that was not based on his feelings. Because I think a lot of times we make our choices based on feelings. But if you make your choices in life based on feelings, you'll never make hard choices. And if you never make hard choices, you'll never make good choices. He made his choice, and it wasn't based on feeling. It was based on his trust in his Savior. It was based on his trust in God Almighty. Listen, some of the best choices you will ever make in your life will be some of the hardest choices you will ever make in your life. He made a choice. I just lost it all. He was probably in shock. Everything was taken. His kids, his wife, his health, his wealth. But you know what his perspective is? You know what? You can take the whole world away from me, but one thing you can never take is my relationship with God Almighty. Nobody can ever take it. Nobody can ever snake it or steal it. Nobody can take away my Jesus. Choice number two. If you want to make the best with most with what you've got, is to be thankful. To be thankful. Thankfulness is a choice. You could choose to be dissatisfied. You could choose to be ungrateful. You can choose to be discouraged. You can choose to throw a pity party, or you can choose to throw a praise party. You can choose to have a victim mentality, or you can choose to have a victorious mentality. The choice is yours. I want us to read this scripture in 1 Thessalonians 5:8 together out loud with your external voices. Let's read this. 1 Thessalonians 5:8. Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. Be thankful in all circumstances. You can be thankful in all circumstances. You know why? Because God is in control. Because God is at work. You know the song, Waymaker? Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. God is working. Touch somebody and tell them, God is working. Tell somebody right now, God is working. Touch somebody else and tell them, God works. God works. I've discovered that God works. He not only works for you, he just works. He just works. If you work God into your life, God will work in your life. I say this about church. Some of you that have attended for any length of time, you've heard me say, church works. Church works. If you go regularly. There's going to be double our attendance on Christmas Eve. And the other half haven't been here since last Christmas Eve. They'll be back probably for Easter. It's like going to the gym. It's almost January 1. And we're all gonna have these goals. January 1, I need to get fit and healthy. You're going to sign up for a gym membership. You're going to go 4 times. You're going to still be paying for it in 5 years. And you're going to look exactly the same. Because it works if you work at it. See, church works if you work it into your life consistently. Jesus will work in your life if you work him into your life, if you make him the priority of your life. You know that God will work for you. In fact, this is what it says in Romans 8:28. Look at this. He says, and we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. I guess we have to find out, does anybody love Jesus today? Because he says he works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. So I can be thankful because I know that God's at work. Instead of looking at my situation, I look at my Savior because he's at work. You might not be able to see it. I think God's greatest miracles are done in the dark. They come out of nowhere. If he showed you the miracle he was working on for your life, you'd be terrified. You wouldn't be able to handle it. He's working in the dark. It's almost like the metaverse. Have you read up on that? Facebook has changed its name to Meta. It needed something for sure. And the metaverse is this virtual world that supposedly we're all going to be in. And the thing about the metaverse is they just went public with it recently. But Zuckerberg and his crew have been working on it behind the scenes for 7 years. We're just now finding out about it. See, sometimes God's greatest works are done in the wonders of the dark. And you may not be able to see it today, but I want you to know that God is working. And so you can be thankful because he is working in your life. He's working in your situation. Listen, perception is everything. How do you choose to see your situation? How do you choose to see your life? The truth is, we don't see the world as it is. We see the world as we are. We all do. We see life through our own lenses, through our own history, our own experiences, our own education, our own successes, our own failures, our own fears. We see life from our own perspective. See, the child who grew up abused, who gets married, is now in a great relationship. And maybe the girl was abused as a child and now she's married to this man. And it's hard for that girl who's now a woman to not think that every time the man says something, that abuse is coming. It's like the dog that you get from the rescue, and you go to the local rescue, and you pick out this cute little puppy, this dog, you take it home, and you go to pet it, and the dog cowers because it's been beaten. You're not gonna beat him. You're there to pet him and to love him. But his experience says, I'm about to get hit. See, we see things through our own experiences, through our own history. But what God wants us to do is see our life through his lens, through his story that we see from God's perspective, from God's viewpoint. And by the way, when you see life from God's perspective, that's called wisdom. And instead of allowing the world to shape your views, I allow the word to shape my views. God's word. See, you've probably heard this saying by now, but it's true that if you change the way you look at things, the way you look at things you look at will change. There's truth to that. Learn to see life from God's perspective, not your own perspective. It's interesting because this is what the Apostle Paul chose to do. I've said this many times, but Paul is my favorite character, person in the Bible. Obviously, Jesus is number one. Paul, for me, is number two. I have to say that because there'll be some idiot that, you know, puts a Google, oh, he didn't even love Jesus. He loves Paul more, you know. So I got to be super, like, careful every word I say, you know. 99% of you already knew that, but it's that one. It's that one. But I love Paul because his story is just insane. To think about a guy that was not a believer, that persecuted Christians, that imprisoned Christians, his whole life purpose was to destroy Christianity, to having an encounter with God and becoming a Christian and becoming a preacher and going on 5 missionary journeys and starting 14 that we know of, key churches, and writing 14 books in our Bible that we read today. That is a remarkable story. I love the story of Paul because if God can do it in him, God can do it in you. Because if God can do it in me, God can do it in you. I love the story because it's about a man of hopelessness who finds hope. A man who tries to kill Christianity who becomes the single greatest evangelist who's ever lived. That is insane. Paul wrote a book. He wrote 4 books from prison. They're called the prison epistles. Isn't that creative? And he wrote the book of Philippians from prison. Do you know what the happiest book in the Bible? They call the happiest book in the book of joy, the happiest book in the Bible is the book of Philippians. It was a book written to the church in the city of Philippi while Paul was in prison in Rome. You know why Paul set out to go to Rome? It was a missionary journey. I'm going to take the gospel to Rome. Paul probably thought, you know what? I'm going to get that Colosseum. We're going to have us a crusade. I might invite Billy Graham. We're going to get everybody saved. We're going to do this real. I'm bringing it. He's not even in Rome yet. He gets arrested. He gets taken to prison. He's in prison for 2 years in Rome. In prison for 2 years. Like, yo, this is not what I was thinking I was going to do. But God had a different plan. Not only was he locked up for 2 years, he was physically chained to a top security agent 24 hours a day for 2 straight years. He was a royal prisoner of Nero. They wanted to make sure the message of Jesus Christ got shut down. Their plan was a terrible plan because to shut it down, they put him in prison. And when he's in prison, he decided to write a bunch of books in the Bible that spread the gospel of Jesus around the world. And here we are 2,000 years later talking about it in Scottsdale, Arizona. The happy book was written from prison for something he didn't do. He didn't do anything. It's not like he was out slanging dope. You know? Wasn't like he's out, you know, like doing stuff he shouldn't be. He didn't do anything. God changed me. You want to know about it? Yeah, you're going to prison. Why? Because if this is still true today, because if the world doesn't like your message, they're going to try to turn it off. They're going to try to turn it off. This is cancel culture. It's nothing new. They tried to cancel Jesus. They tried to cancel the gospel. You can try to shut it up. You can try to shut it down. But the gospel message is going to keep rolling like a freight train. It is not able to be stopped. And the more you try to stop it, the faster it grows. It's going to spread like wildfire. On New Year's Eve, I'm going to preach a sermon kicking off a series called Viral. And what God's put in my heart, I almost can't contain it. It's going to be bananas. It's going to be crazy. This viral sermon, it's going to be crazy. And so for the first time on Christmas Eve, we're going to do a Christmas Eve New Year's Eve. We're going to do a New Year's Eve service. I've never done one. I'm not a night person. Don't know how that's going to go. From 10 to noon, maybe. Would y'all stay that long? All the 20-year-olds. We're going to kick it off at midnight. No, we're going to kick it off at 10. I'm going to confuse all of you by the time this is over. We're going to kick it off at 10. We're going to end it whenever we're done, probably midnight something. But here's my question. I have a question. I know that a lot of you are used to going out and getting lit on New Year's Eve. Am I right, though? Yep. So I know you're church folk, but a lot of church folk like to go get lit on New Year's Eve. And so my question is this. Do you think for just one New Year's Eve, just one, you could not go out and get drunk and load it up with alcohol and liquor, and instead you could come to our New Year's Eve service and get drunk on the Holy Spirit with us? I see this whole section. I ain't clapping for that. I ain't clapping, man. Nope. And here's the crazy thing about those of you that drink. This is the biggest lie that we tell ourselves when you're drinking. Because I know some of you, you're going to come, but you're going to get lit before you come. Real talk. But the biggest lie that people who drink tell themselves is this, that we can't smell it on you. So for New Year's Eve, I'm going to be in the lobby saying hi to everybody. I just want you to know we can smell it. We can smell it. You still should come. Some of you be coming, taking a swig between worship songs. I know it. We're on to you. None of this is in my notes. None of this. But I'm going to kick off this series called Viral, and I'm excited about it, but I've been thinking a lot about this idea, because if it weren't for hardships and persecution and difficulties and even death, you and I would not be here today worshiping the newborn king. People paid a price. Have you? People paid a price. Have you? Because I think the church needs to shift from feel-good messages to be good and do good messages. And I know that's not the tickle of the ear that everybody wants to hear. But a cost was paid. In fact, the persecution of the early church and the early disciples wasn't even about the disciples. It was about you. The cross that Jesus died on wasn't even about Jesus. It was about you. It was about you. What I'm saying is that no matter how bad your situation seems today, God is at work, and he's going to work out fearfully and wonderfully your life with this plan that he has the ultimate goal, the ultimate blessing, the ultimate future, the ultimate end result for your life, but you have to trust him with that process. You can be thankful even in your situation, and I want to talk a little bit more about Paul, because the story of Paul is crazy. He said, I'm locked up. I'm chained to this dude. Can you imagine being chained to a person 24 hours a day? Some of you are like, that's my marriage, PT, right now. I'm just like, can you imagine being chained to a person who hates you? Who hates you, who hates what you're about. There, a lot of these high-level security agents were Nero's family. You know what Paul says? Paul goes, imagine writing some books chained to some dude that hates you, hates what you're about. Imagine, he's like, hey, if you don't mind, I gotta write some stuff for my church friends, you know? He's like, hey, I'm thinking about killing you, so I don't know, we'll see how it goes. Well, I just wanted to write some stuff. And there was no pens. There was no computers. There's no laptops. There's no Word. There's no pages. I mean, this is like old school writing. And Paul's perspective is crazy, because he goes, man, I came here to preach the gospel the way I thought I was going to preach the gospel. But God flipped the switch. And now I'm preaching the gospel the way he wanted me to preach the gospel. And because I'm preaching the gospel the way he wanted me to preach the gospel, I'm in prison preaching the gospel, chained to this dude who hates my guts. But guess what? Now this dude got saved. And there's a lot of people in prison getting saved because I'm chained to them 24. They're going to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 2 years. My perspective is that the devil can bring all the smoke he wants, but nothing can stop God. Nothing can kill my joy. It's the book of joy. I want to read you a couple verses about his perspective. Highlights from the book of Philippians, chapter 1, verse 21. For to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. 4:6 of Philippians, don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Chapter 4, verse 7, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. He's saying all this stuff from prison. Philippians 1, 6, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to the completion of the day of Jesus Christ. Philippians 1, 12. And I want you to know, my dear brothers and sisters, that everything that has happened to me here has helped to spread the good news. See, perspective is everything. It's everything. Nero's family members, he writes this. This is in the book. Nero's family members are getting saved because they're chained to the Apostle Paul all day, every day. Have you ever considered that maybe your chains might actually be about setting someone else free? Your chains might not even be about you. Actually, they're probably not about you. We make everything about us, but your chains probably aren't even about you. Just like the cross of Jesus Christ really wasn't about him. It was about you. So no matter what you're going through this Christmas, the choice is yours. You choose to be thankful. By the way, you can be thankful because last I checked, God is still on the throne and he is doing something big. Let's look at number three. Number three. This is a big one. I'm going to crush us all right here. This is the one where you either don't ever come back again or you just can't get enough. We'll see. Number three, choose to be content. Content. Contentment's a crazy thing, isn't it? God wants us to be godly and content. Godly and content. To be content with what I have. To be content with what I don't have, to be content with my situation, even if it's not great. But we live in this world that's discontent. It's just discontent, right? We chase the newest technology. A new phone comes out every year. Some of y'all got to get the new one every time the new one comes out. Even though the one from 10 years ago, I still don't even know all the cool stuff it does. We got to get the newest laptop, the newest technology, the newest car, the newest model of that car. We got to get a bigger house, a better house that we think is better, a better neighborhood, a better situation. I wish I made more money. I wish I had a better job. I wish I could get a promotion. I wish I married a different person. You know what? I need to get some plastic surgery. I'm not really happy with myself. I want to get a facelift. Or whatever. You know what? I'm gonna get a boob job. Get some boobs lifted. I'll get my butt lifted. My booty needs to be lifted. My boobies need to be lifted. My boobies, they all need a lifting because there's this thing in Earth called gravity and we all hate gravity. I'm gonna get my cheeks lifted, my forehead lifted. Don't act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. We're in Scottsdale, Arizona right now. Now, we have people watching online from all over the planet. You don't even know what I'm talking about unless you actually live right here in this city. This struggle is real. I'm just saying, it's real. I need boobs. I don't need boobs anymore. Get them out of here. They're making me sick. I don't care if they're sick. I need them. I'm not going to ask. Even it's just not a women thing. Dudes are getting pectoral implants. I'm gonna have to change the subject. But at least you guys are feeling me. You're right there. But what God wants is for us to learn to be content with who he is in our life and what he gives us in our life. And if I'm going to really make the most of my situation, I need to learn contentment. I need to trust that God knows best. Now, I'm not saying don't go get your stuff done because we want you looking good. So don't. I'm just saying you really have to think about motives. Motives. Why do I want what I want? Why do I want what I want? What is the motive inside of what I want? Why do I want that new model of a Range Rover? Why do I want that new model of a Rolls Royce? Why do I want that new model? Why do I want something that I don't have? See, there's two killers of contentment, two major killers of contentment. One is greed. The other is envy. And they kind of run together. Greed is when I want stuff I don't have. I want it. I want it bad. Greed is I don't have enough money. I need to make more money. Greed is I have everything I need and then some, but I'm not generous. I don't share any of my anything with anybody. Greed is a disease that has ran rampant through our world today. Greed. Greed. So greed is a killer of contentment because I'm never satisfied with what I already have and what I already am. The other one is envy because envy is a result of me seeing something that you have that I want. Envy is, I wish I had that person's marriage. Oh, I wish I had that person's health. Oh, I wish I had that person's metabolism. Oh, I wish I looked good like that person. Oh, I wish I lived in that neighborhood. I wish I had that house. I wish I had those kind of parents. I wish I had a mother like that. I wish I had a daddy like that. I can relate to all of that. You know, I can especially relate to the father because I don't have a father in my life. I don't. And you know that every time I see somebody post a picture on social media with their father, that I always think, man, that would be cool if I had a dad like that. That would be cool if I had a dad where I could go hunting, even though I don't hunt. That'd be a cool thing if I had a dad where I could go golfing, even though I don't golf. Just the dad part's cool. But the Lord showed me a few years ago when I was processing through a lot of this that he said, you're the dad, I'm the dad that you need, and I'm the only father that you need. Wow. You know what's crazy is, this is what's really crazy is, I'm just gonna be super like uncomfortably honest. I have pastor friends all over the country that had great pastor dads. A lot of them took over their daddy's church. And I find myself at times like, you guys understand, we all have a story and it's not supposed to be like somebody else's story. I'm not being boastful. I'm not being arrogant. I hope it doesn't come across this way. Do you know what I could do for the kingdom of God if I had a dad hand me a church that already had 10,000 people in it, 5,000 people in it, 1,000 people in it, that had money in the bank? But see, my story is different because we started with nothing. In fact, when I said yes to step into this church was 200 people. That's maybe the first like five rows across this place. 200 people facing foreclosure, 4 months behind in its mortgage payment, no money in the bank. I didn't take a paycheck for a year and lived off savings just to hope that we could get this thing off the ground. I used to say, good thing we're next to the runway in case this plane crashes, we're right here. I'm trying to be transparent with you to tell you that I understand those pains. But I also know that God has told me that he's everything I need. He's the only thing I need. And just like Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. So if anybody wants to be my dad, I'm taking applications. First and foremost, you got to love Jesus Christ with all your heart, soul, your mind, and your strength. Second of all, you need to be insanely wealthy. Because I'm ready to break some generational curses. Our whole family comes from poverty. I'm ready to just do something different in my life. And so for us, it's a big lesson on contentment. And God gave me this phrase the other day, and I want to share it with you. Because I was dealing with something in my own life, and I didn't like it. I didn't like what I was dealing with. I didn't like the direction this was going. But he popped this phrase in my heart, and this is the phrase. I'm good with whatever God's good with. I'm good with whatever you're good with, Lord. Help me to trust you and help me to be content. I want to read you a couple scriptures on this in 1 John. The Bible says, do not love the world or anything in the world. That's hard to do, isn't it? Isn't it? Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life is not from the Father, but from the world. The world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God remains forever. It's greed. It's chasing the things of this world. I want to read you what Paul said in Philippians 4 again. In Philippians, he said, not that I was ever in need, for I've learned to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or an empty, with plenty, with little, for I can do everything through Christ. I can do all things through Christ. I can do anything through Christ who gives me strength. So I'm good with what God's good with. Would you bow your heads with me and we'll close in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. And God, we thank you that you are all that we need. You're everything we need. You are Jireh. You are our provider. You see us through. You are our portion. You are our daily bread, the manna that drops from the sky right when we need it. You're the God of the impossible. You're the God who's always on time. You're the God who cares. A God of compassion, of grace, mercy. A God who loved the world so much that you sent your Son into this world to die for us. And God, that is why we celebrate this Christmas season. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you, God. You are a way maker. You are a miracle worker. You are a promise keeper. God, there's no pain, there's no hurt. There's no struggle, there's no affliction, there's no addiction that you don't see, that you don't want to see us through. God, we are grateful. And Lord, I pray that as the busyness of this week leading into Christmas Day, Lord, that we don't get so caught up in throwing a party that we miss the whole point of the party. God, that we fall down to our knees and we worship you. If you're here today and you've never prayed to surrender your life to Jesus Christ, I hope that you'll do that today. I pray that you'll do that today. It's the greatest decision I ever made in my own life, is to say, God, I'm yours and I'm all in. Because if you work God into your life, God will work in your life. Today, you just pray and ask him, Jesus, today, I invite you to be my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your grace and mercy. We pray this in Jesus' name. We all say, amen.